Okay, let's see if we're good to go. Thanks for having me here. My name is Maarten Mulders. I work as an architect, lead developer, trainer, speaker, well, what not actually, at InfoSupport, a company based in Venendaal. Some people say you're first class, some other people say you just can't choose. I prefer first class. Anyway, tonight I want to share with you a story about my energy meter. If you do have the Dutch Java magazine at home, you might have read my article, which was published, I think, 2 days ago. But just in case you either didn't have the magazine or didn't read it yet, we'll cover everything here. So what's up? I'll start with a short background, how I came up with the idea. We'll look at how to connect a smart energy meter, how to build a web dashboard for that, and obviously there will be room for questions at the end. Might you have any questions up front, just raise your hand. I mean, it's a small group, it's no problem at all. So, first of all, I used to have one of these, and I think everybody knows what this is. This is just a old school energy meter. There's a small disc over there. It just turns and turns and turns around, indicating that it's actually recording your energy usage, your electricity. And the nice thing about this device is that anytime you want to, you can walk to it, look at the numbers there or there, and see how much energy you have actually consumed until then. But this is not a talk about the 1990s, this is a talk about the 21st century. And a few years ago, my energy meter was replaced with a brand new device with a flashing light and a barcode and a LED display and button, and I can't see the energy usage anymore. Now the thing is, at the end of the year you'll get an invoice from your energy company saying that you've used a certain amount of energy and you need to pay for that. Or maybe you did already pay for that. But how can I check that? Because I can't see it anymore. Yes, well, you can. You should press the button 2 times and then wait 5 seconds and then it will tell you. That's not fun. And on the other hand, there's a very small flip over there, and if you lift the flip, there's a connector. And that got my my interest, that little flip. I should plug something in it and then maybe I can do stuff with the device, make it smart. Because the thing is, it's called a smart meter, but it's not smart. What this smart meter will do, it will collect your energy usage data and periodically send that over GPRS to some central system somewhere, I don't know where, probably in the cloud because everything is in the cloud. And then you can register with other companies and they will give you some kind of fancy web dashboard where you can see how much energy you consume. But I don't like that idea. First of all, this meter is sending data over the air. Is that secure? I cannot check if it's secure. Then there's this other website that allows me to view any energy meter's usage. But I don't want anyone to see my energy usage, I just want to see it myself. Because if I can see it and somebody else can also see it, then maybe he can determine whether I'm at home or not, whether I'm on a vacation or not. And so maybe think about going into my house and stealing stuff. So I decided to turn off that feature. It's opt-out, so you just fill in a form and then they stop doing that. And then you get the old papers, forms back, with which you periodically tell the energy company how much energy did you consume. But as I said, there was this little flip over there with a RG11 connector. It's the same connector as it's in old desktop telephones. Everyone here is old enough to know that there's other phones than smartphones, so that's a good thing. They used to have a certain cable with a small connector which looks like Ethernet, but it's actually smaller, which is called RG11. And if you go on a hunt for documentation, you'll find that there's smart meter requirements from Netbeheer Nederland. Netbeheer Nederland is the company that actually specifies how energy data is to be collected through at all the households in the Netherlands. And they describe how the devices should submit energy data, but they also describe how this port is supposed to work. So I looked up in the specification, there's an RG11 port, it has a certain pin layout, and if you supply some power on the first pin, if you supply 5 volts over there, then on the third pin, fifth pin, you can get data from your device. Well, that's interesting. At least to me it is interesting, because I want to see what I can get out of this device. The other pins aren't used, but you should supply the ground at least. So I decided to go and see if I could get that to work. And my first attempt was an eBay shopping list. I thought I needed a RG11 to USB connector. This is a USB female, so I need a male-to-male connector, because otherwise I can't plug it into my computer. Well, you go on a hunt on eBay, and if you're a bit smart, and if you're a bit Dutch, most of all, because then you're looking for the lowest prices, you can come to about $4, which is 3.5 euros at the time of writing, which is a nice price, and it's even with shipping included. It just takes 2 weeks, but well, who cares? So 2 weeks later, two separate packages from China arrived. All were commercial samples, of course, not customer goods. I decided to plug in this one in the energy meter, that one into the female side, and that one into the computer, the Raspberry, and I just waited. And I waited quite a long time, because nothing actually happened, which I thought was very disappointing. So I went on a search for help on the hardware-related forum, and I explained what I wanted to do, and what I've tried so far. And the answer shocked me a bit, because the answer was, you should immediately plug it out, you can blow up either your Raspberry or your smart meter, or even worse, you can blow up both. Because you don't know what is connected how inside this tiny thingy over there. Maybe they have the wrong pin layout inside, you can't see it. Oops. I don't want to blow up either side of the insulation, so I pull out the cables and decided that although it's very cheap, this is not the way to go. I'm not good with soldering, I don't even have the devices for that, and if I would have, I would probably burn my whole house, so that was not an option either. So I decided for the very un-Dutch option of buying a prefab cable for €20. That hurts if you thought you were ready with 3.5 euros and 20 euros is a lot. But this cable is certified to be tested with an energy meter by the company that ships it. It's a company in Eindhoven, so if you don't like the cable, you can go there and complain about it, as you won't go to China to complain about the cable. And this one got shipped within 1 day, so it was a lot faster to get it. And I decided to plug it in and open up the pseudo serial line that was created by just plugging in the USB slot. And then at least I got some data. I figured out that for serial lines there are several speeds at which data is sent, and if you look in the specification by Napier, then you can find that there's no parity bit to be used, and that you should have a baud rate of 150,200. So if you specify it correctly, you'll get some output in the terminal. I don't know if you can already, but it says something like KM5 Kaifa meter, then a bunch of numbers, and then there's a exclamation mark and 4016. This is the CU utility, which comes with every line distribution. And you can do tilde dots to have your serial line disconnected. So the good thing is, I have a connection, and there appears to be some data that might be readable. And the next thing that you need to do is make sense of all these numbers. Because it's, okay, it's a number, how do you read them? Like so. As you can see, there's a lot of numbers inside the message. And a lot of them, well, there's something with kilowatt hours, and there's something with S, there's kilowatt, there's ampere over there. But you got to make sense of all this. And that's, again, the point where the specifications come in very handy, because they describe exactly what this message should turns out that there's a very simple structure, actually. Every message should start with a forward slash, followed by three letters. Don't know which ones. The number 5, for whatever reason, but 5. And then some kind of, the rest of the line is reserved for the meter to identify itself to you as a customer. Then a blank line, and then a lot of lines, as many as needed, followed by, at the end, the exclamation mark and some kind of CRC. It's a check number, so you can verify that your you did read the message correctly. Well, the identification is something that the vendor of the device can think of himself, so there's no rules for that. And the data all follow the same pattern. Each line starts with an OBIS reference, and then between normal brackets there will be the value for that OBIS reference. And the last line is a CRC 16 checksum over everything from the very first forward slash until the exclamation mark. And as I said, you can use that. If you calculate the same number, then it should match the last line, obviously. So, well, at least now I know how this message is built up, what I can find in there. There's a very big table inside this specification from NetBear, and they will tell you every possible OBIS reference, including its meaning. And we need that to actually make any sense of this data. Well, I won't go through all the OBIS references here, they're a bit boring. Many of them you don't even actually need for regular usage. But there's things like, how many, watts do I actually consume right now? Or how many watts do I actually produce right now? If you have got some solar collectors on your roof, which I do not have, by the way, but just imagine. There's lines for how many gas did I consume. There's lines for the total energy that I consumed ever since the meter was installed. And some of them are actually doubled because many people in the Netherlands, just like me, have a two tariff system where you have a higher tariff during the day and a lower tariff during the night and in the weekend. Well, if you want to parse this data, then you need something to, well, actually extract interesting values from it. At the time that I was starting this project, I was very interested in Scala and in Akka. I still am, by the way. So I decided, I read about this parser combinator stuff, that I wanted to use Scala parser combinators. Might not be the best option to do it, but at least it's a fun project to learn. So, how to parse this data? As I said, Scala parser combinators, I wanted to try them. And parser combinators are actually two things, parsers and combinators, hence the name. Let's take a simple example. Imagine if I have this this text here, it's 3 0s 6.5.3.5, and I would like to interpret that as a number. Well, that's what parsing is about, making some other structure from text. Of course, I could do just a new big decimal or a big decimal of value of, but well, this is another approach. You can write a parser using Scala constructions, where you say I expect or I have a regular expression with a decimal number n times, probably a dot, and then one more, zero more other decimal numbers. By putting them inside a triple quote, I don't have to escape the backslashes, which I would regularly do if I was using Java, which is the main cause that regular expressions in Java always go wrong, because you always forget about the number of backslashes. The .r method isn't there in Java, but it's there in Scala, and it's an easy way to make a regular expression from a string that represents a regular expression. But now you have a regex object. And then there's the two carrots, followed by a block, which say, if you have some text that matches this regular expression, then execute the following block of code using the text that matches this number. And in my case, I want to just invoke the big decimal constructor using the value that matched the regular expression. And the value, I don't have to give it a name, I can just use underscore, which is in Scala a placeholder for, well, just the value. I don't care what it's named. So, having done that, I can write simple parsers for
for example, numbers. I called it number.
But then things might get more complicated, because actually the whole line reads,
this owner's reference, followed by brackets, followed by number, asterisk sign, KWH. So I need to somehow get rid of these other things. And I can do that by saying, for example, I have a parser for electricity consumption on tablet 1. Well, this is the owner's reference for current consumption on tablet 1. Then there's still the bigger than, the previous parser that I had for numbers. And then asterisk, kilowatt-hour, bracket close. And this construction needs to actually mean that you are not interested in either this value or that value, but you actually want some input that matches this whole line, but you're only interested in the middle part of it. And you can specify that using these tilde arrow-like construction. So it lets you get rid of this stuff that you're not interested in. Very powerful there. And again, if some line matches this whole thing, then take only the part of the line that matches this regular expression, feed that to this block, which means invoke the big decimal constructor and return the value. So as you can see, there's, well, this actually is also a parser. It's a parser that matches exactly this string. Very simple parser. So it's this one. And these are the combinators. They combine parsers together and also specify what to do with the combined result, like drop the left part, or drop the right part, or keep both of the parts maybe. And using these constructions, you can build very powerful hierarchies of parsers that each parse very tiny parts of your input, but together they can parse the whole message in total. So if you build up this whole tree, you'll finally end with something like, okay, the first line, for example, is constructed from three letters or numbers, and I can store that in a string. Well, it's an easy one. It's a string. I can store it in a string. Well, still need to specify that. Same holds for the identification. Now the whole header line is the make followed by the identification. That together, and I want to have both of the values so that tilde is not followed by an arrow sign or preceded by an arrow sign. And I can make a P1 header object from that. The P1 header object is just a simple case class in Scala that I constructed, which is just a placeholder for these two values. And using that, I can build even bigger parsers. Like saying, I have a telegram. A telegram consists of a header, some metadata, the real data that I'm interested in, and the checksum. And I want to have all of these, so there's only the tildes. And now I can say that I want to have a parser. And the parser is actually this one. And anything that matches this structure of these four elements should yield in this new P1 telegram case class. Or, and this is also a combinator, if something does not match this whole structure, I can throw a parse failure saying, I have some input which I did not expect and I don't know how to handle. This is one of the biggest files actually in the whole solution that I came up with, because it needs to specify each and every of these OBIS references for all the fields that I'm interested in. We won't go through the whole file, it's way too long and it's way too boring as well. Now, as I said, I wanted to experiment with Scala and with Akka, so I decided that I would use Akka to build some kind of a API with a dashboard in front of it. Are you familiar with Akka somehow? A bit, a lot, yes. I would expect that from you, actually. In a nutshell, Akka is all about messaging. Messaging between objects inside a JVM, or maybe in multiple JVMs, but that's a way too far from now. It's sending messages between actors, as they are called, and these actors can implement logic. Now the funny thing is messaging, and this meter does not
continuously spam me with messages. It waits 10 seconds, and then it sends the next message. So actually, my smart meter itself is kind of an actor. It's sending messages every 10 seconds. That's interesting. That fits quite well to the Akka model. So I decided to go with Akka, and I came up with a diagram that looked almost like this. This is the whole solution. I have a smart meter somewhere. It sends some bits and bytes over the wire, which I leave up to the operating system to decode. I have my system, which I have called Hyperion. If you want to know why, we should catch up the drinks. Pause. It's a long story. Hyperion will talk to some kind of database where I can write meter readings to, because one of the requirements from my project manager, aka my wife, was that she wanted to be able to see what the energy used was at a certain date back in time. Mm. Well, okay, nice requirement, we can build that and we can use a database for that. It's a bit enterprisey, but yes, we should do that. And there's some kind of a web application that implements all the views for it. And it will both yield live data from the dashboard as well as historical information that was retrieved from the database. Now, if we look into Hyperion, we can see that it all starts with the IO serial actor. It's an actor that I didn't write myself. It's just an open source Akka extension, which allows you to read or write messages over the serial line using Akka. And it does all that kind of magic things with native code, because the JVM cannot access serial lines in Linux. But that doesn't matter. It's all abstracted away for you. And the only thing that you need to do is start this actor and tell this actor who is to receive the data. Now, I've called that the collecting actor. It's the one that just slurps in data. And it will receive messages from this serial actor over there. They're called serial.received, and inside this Akka message are just the raw bytes. So I still need to make a string out of that, but I just have the bytes. What this collecting actor will do is just append every byte that it receives, or maybe it's a batch of bytes, I don't really know, but I don't have to know either. And it will do a very simple check. If there's an exclamation mark followed by four characters, that's the end of the message. That's not parsing yet, that's just, well, maybe I'm done by now. If that happens to be the case, it will construct a big string out of that and send it to the P1 parser that we just discussed. The P1 parser will try to make sense out of that, and it will either give back the telegram or some kind of a parse for you. And if it gives back a P1 telegram, then I can send a telegram received message to my message distributor, which is right there down below. Now, this message distributor is actually the core of the rest of the system, because now it's also down there. It allows other actors to register themselves, saying, I'm interested in your messages. Please give them to me as you receive them. And the message distributor will then forward any message that it receives to every subscripted actor. So it's just actually a very simple messaging bus, if you wish. At least it sounds enterprising. Some kind of a bus where people can register, get updated whenever a new message arrives, and they can unsubscribe themselves by either just killing themselves or sending a message saying that they're no longer interested. So there's a few other actors here that actually use this message distributor, and when the system boots up, they will be instantiated, and they will say to the message distributor, hi there, if you have any messages, please let me know. And then, as the message distributor gets a telegram received message, it will just forward it to each and every one of them. Now, there's three actors at this moment. One is a recent history actor, which basically does keep track of the last 1 hour of messages that it has received. It uses a ring buffer for that, so you don't need to worry about overflowing or something. It will just keep the last 60 minutes of messages, and you can use it to have a small graph of your usage over the last hour, if you find it interesting. You can use that, for example, to see what kind of impact your vacuum cleaner has, or what kind of impact your brand new television has. Because you switch on the television and you immediately see your graph going up. Then there's the daily history actor over there at the right. That's a very worrying actor because it sleeps most of the time. It wakes up at midnight, waits for the very first message to receive, stores that into the database, and puts itself to sleep for another 24 hours. I like it. It's like sleeping for 24 hours. That's all it does. Nothing more, nothing less. In the meantime, if it would receive a message saying, give me some historical meter reading for a specific date, it will go to the database, look it up, and give it back. And then it will sleep even longer. And in the middle is a handler that is not instantiated by default. It's only instantiated if you connect to one of the endpoints of the application. And if you do that, you should upgrade your connection to a WebSocket connection. Why is that? Because if it's a WebSocket connection, you can get push. You can get data pushed back to your client. That's interesting because if you connect and you upgrade to a WebSocket connection, then what this actor will do, it will start an ACA stream. And using this ACA stream, it will it will process any message that it gets from the message distributor, convert it to some kind of nice JSON structure, and send it back to your web browser. So what you will get if you do that is that you have a live view of the actual data coming from your smart meter. Every 10 seconds it will update with new data. Well, the last part of this all was building some kind of a nice web dashboard. And I decided that I wanted, well, a web application that would just talk with my REST APIs. I would have liked to have some separation between the user interface and the data that is being processed. Of course, a single page application, because, well, that's hip by now, so we're going to do a single page application. And something that allows me to work with small components that I could assemble together into some kind of a web app. I decided to go for React, which turned out to be a very nice framework, by the way. I really enjoy working with that. And with React, you can use, you're actually encouraged to use all kinds of new ECMAScript 6 constructions, like, for example, classes, which is not in JavaScript as we all know it. If you want to have classes in JavaScript, you need to do funky things with function prototypes and well, I don't know what. I do know of guys who love to write it by hand. I don't, because they don't understand how to do it, and so we will probably make mistakes. But I do understand this is just simple object-oriented programming. I have a ECMAScript 6 class, which is called the current readings service. It has a constructor, just like Java, which instantiates some kind of an instance variable, page URL, by looking up the location of the API and doing some string formatting over there, saying if you connect to WSS, which is WebSockets over SSL, some kind of hostname slash API slash actual, that together is the endpoint that you need. Now if you construct this object, you can call the connect method on it, which will actually make the connection to the specified endpoint. This and you need to give a callback, and the callback will be invoked on every message that your web browser receives through the WebSocket connection. And the handling is actually very simple. It will be some data, try to parse that because we know it's JSON, and invoke the callback method with that JavaScript object that you get from there. And you can also call disconnect on this object, and it will just close the WebSocket connection. That's all. Not really very hard, but, well, nicely isolated stuff.
Sorry.
Yeah.
Question.
Sure.
So if I got it right, you're also performing the beginning, let me put it that way, of your REST calls through React.
React itself does not have anything for making REST calls.
Yeah, I know, but what is this base URL doing in the constructor?
This base URL is just remembering where to find the API endpoint. This is just a, you could say it's kind of a service class. This doesn't do anything unless I invoke it from my web application. This is not even React.
So this will come from WebSocket then?
This is just a standard WebSocket API
that's
present in each and every browser.
Yeah.
Maybe except Internet Explorer.
You got it now, yeah.
Cool. Sure. Great. So if we all react to that, we can actually use this service. We have a very small React component here. There's a component did mount function, which is invoked when the component is actually put on a page, effectively put on the page. And what it will do, it will connect to this instance of the class that we just saw, invoke the connect method, give it supplying some kind of callback. And what will the callback do? It will update the state of this specific component. State is managed in React by the component itself, so it's the only one who knows about it. And if the component is at some point in time disconnected from the page, then we also want to disconnect the connection to avoid resource leakage. Same class, the main thing there in each and every React component is the render method. And the render method is what actually puts something visible on the screen. And in this case, it will make a grid, which is some other component. I won't dive into that right here. And the grid contains rows, and each row has a column. And as you can see, I have a method here, make row, for a certain label and value, I can make a row inside a table. Well, the first row I want to be last updated, and the value for that row is the timestamp from the message that I received on the website. And so on and so forth. There's electricity consumption, there's electricity production, and if I do have a gas meter, which is not by default, so people might be having a smart energy meter but not a gas meter. But if I have one, then I also want to add an extra row saying what's the last data that I received from my gas meter. And I can also see what the current tariff is, either low or high. Now, as you can see, this is just a helper function. It creates a row inside a table with two columns with a certain size. And this is together creating a nice table, which looks more or less like this.
Cool. Oh, sorry, it was quick.
It was very quick, yeah. I chose the name long before you asked me to talk here.
I know.
Don't worry, yes. So this is what it looked like yesterday night. As you can see, I'm always very early with updating my slides.
This is live, right?
Sorry?
We should make this live.
Well, we could try to make it live, sure. I'll enable my hotspot already. As you can see, it has some data that's actually coming straight from the energy meter, like the timestamp when the message was received, the current electricity tariff, how much electricity am I consuming or producing, well, zero, because as I said, I have no solar panels, and my gas consumption is some 3,000 square meters. Well, this is always an exciting moment to see if you have... my Wi-Fi hotspot doesn't come up yet. There it is. There it is. Fingers crossed for this one. This can take up to 10 seconds because you get data only every 10 seconds, as I said. Did anyone talk, by the way?
We are staring at a nice progress bar.
Yeah, so am I. I showed it to my colleagues the other day. They said they frightened them a bit.
Right.
Yeah, they said it's too active. It should be more quiet. I think it takes a little longer than 10 seconds. Let's do a refresh here. Ah, that's why. Yeah. And if you wait a few seconds, you might see 166 changing.
Yeah.
165. Well, the last 1 minute of data, last 1 hour of data, I mean, as you can see, it shows you a nice graph from 1759 to 1859, give or take a few seconds. And it will show you the energy consumption at that point in time. I don't know what's happening at home. It's not very shocking to me, actually. I did some experiments when I got this because I wanted to know whether it was actually working or not. And the first experiment that I did was this one. Any idea what I was doing when the energy rose from 120 watts to more than 2000 watts?
Your oven?
Oven, no.
Water.
It wasn't the oven, but it was kind of a similar thing.
Yeah,
when it comes to energy usage. It was the water cooker that's in the kitchen. And just to prove it, it says 2,280 watts over there. Maybe it's a bit hard to see, it's a bit dark, but it actually matches what I would expect from the device itself. Just another experiment. Well, it's a bit longer, it's from 1240 to 1306, so that's some 15 minutes. That's not a water cooker. Happily not, because it would take very long to make a cup of tea.
It's too constant.
Sorry?
It's too constant.
It is very constant. It's at 1375 against,
yeah.
Well, 150.
Vacuum cleaner.
Vacuum cleaner, excellent. It was a vacuum cleaner, which is saying that it uses 1200 watts, which is give or take the difference that we saw in the graph. So this was, of course, a very scientific proof that my solution actually worked, because I did an experiment with two devices and both of them were correct. Are there any questions left?
Now that you have this, could you distill which appliance is being run based on this graph? Let's say you run your water cooker and your vacuum cleaner.
Theoretically, you might be able to guess it. Like if you register for each and every significant energy consuming device, what its specified consumption is, then you could be like, well, I see a 200 watt increase, and that's almost the amount of my television, for example. But it would be more than guessing. It would be more guessing than calculating. Because you don't know which combination of devices leads to a certain energy uses. And some devices are not very constant when it comes to that.
You distill that with, if you know the characteristics each device separately.
Like it runs for 5 minutes at 2000 watts, for example. Yeah.
And you have those characteristics. And maybe with the Fourier transformation, you could split them out again. So you get a superposition of all the usage together.
Well, I don't know that much about Fourier calculations. Maybe it's possible. I don't dare to say. I never tried it, actually.
So in the neural network against this.
That was my other idea. You could run artificial intelligence with something that you don't understand either. Like neural network, for example. I actually never thought of that. I did use it to figure out for some devices, like a new lamp that we bought. Is it actually, does it use a lot of energy or not? And you can easily see that using this light graph, because you just refresh it a minute later and you can see whether it rose a lot or not. But what I think to myself, it's easier to just look around the house and see, I left the oven on, then have some kind of difficult calculations that determine that maybe the oven is on. Then it's quicker to just walk to the kitchen and see that it's on or not. But who knows, maybe it's possible. I never thought of it myself, actually, to do that. I did think of another idea, by the way, but that's another story. Any more questions?
We're all
using the output.
a pin for input, but the specification says you can't send anything to it. I didn't try. I should have tried things like set consumption column zero. I didn't try that.
The input is only in one host switch. If you have input low, then there's no. If you put input high, then you get high.
There is output. And that actually, that is input. There's also a pin that says input, but it doesn't do anything. But this is interesting. What would happen if you boot something related to it? I think nothing will happen.
Figured out what the baseline is, the 150 watts.
At that moment, you mean?
Yeah, or...
Oh, it was probably something like the light being on or something. I think it was in the winter, so that you had light something during midday. Or it could have been, for example, the device that heats up your water, or the network attached storage, or the Wi-Fi router, stuff like that. The Raspberry itself.
The doorbell.
The doorbell. Could be anything.
I'm not sure if it was a goal for you, but did it change your behavior regarding consumption?
That was not a goal, but we did. It did make us more aware of when selecting new stuff for a house. It did make us more aware of the fact that you have a choice. Mm-hmm. That there are lamps, for example, that use a lot of energy, and lamps that use not that much energy. So it created some awareness, but it didn't really change behavior. Another one. One off.
You are physically connected to the meter, right?
That's right.
Is there also another solution? Because my meter is somewhere down by the neighbors.
Well, I did use a USB extension cable because the distance was a bit big.
I don't think that's a solution for me.
You might. The first thing that I actually tried was having two computers, like the Raspberry and some other computer, mm-hmm. and then using Akka remoting. So the Raspberry would just receive the message and live close to the meter, mm-hmm. and then the other computer would do all that heavy processing, which turned out not to be that heavy. So it could run on the Raspberry as well. And it could live somewhere else, maybe in the cloud or maybe somewhere in the data center that's called my home. But as I said, Akka remote is a totally different story. The manual is okay, that's not the problem, but having it set up correctly is some more work, and you need to do all kind of error handling, like what if the remote actually doesn't live? You don't know. You can't guarantee it's alive because it's in a different machine. Maybe it's in there. So that adds a lot of complexity that I actually didn't need. But you could think of something like that, and then you can maybe run the data receiving part on a very tiny device, not a Raspberry, but a Raspberry Zero, or maybe even smaller. Maybe you could use that. But I never tried that because, as I said, it adds too much complexity, actually.
How about adding the water meter as well? It's not smart.
It's not smart. That's the simple answer. The water meter is a plain old device with a meter somewhere down below the floor. It's not smart enough. So that's not an option. I did think, by the way, of adding another table in the database with the current electricity tariff, so I could actually do a forecasting of my energy bill at the end of the year. Mm-hmm. But it's still the backlog.
Well, maybe you can connect a camera to your Raspberry Pi, and which monitors the water meter.
With your image processing.
And does it,
No, but this was the thing of recognizing for the old meters.
Exactly. Yeah. When you had the very old meters with the disk that returns, that turns around, people did do things like that, like having a camera, look at the disk, and the disk would have a tiny red dot on it, and every time you saw a red dot, you knew you had a tick I don't know, maybe 1 kilowatt or something. Extra consumption. That's the almost smart meter, maybe. One last question. Interesting.
Yeah, I have a question. Do you know how much time you spent creating this? Because I'm always curious.
It's a nice question. It depends on who you ask. If you ask me, well, not that much. If you ask my wife, way too much. Yeah.
Okay.
No, I have no clue. Actually, I spent quite some days and nights on it. Actually, the stream part, for example, was new to me. It was very hard to get that right. Mm-hmm. The parsing was quite a lot of time. On the other hand, sending and receiving messages turned out to be pretty easy, especially if you have every actor just log a message for every just like a warning for every message that it received but that it did not expect to receive. That saves a lot of time when you're troubleshooting stuff. Where's my message go? You know, when it's received, oh, he's receiving it. I promise that, send it to him. Well, that's the kind of things that you are to save yourself some time. But I think quite some days, actually.
Okay.
Thanks, everyone.
Thanks a lot, Martin.